Well, good morning and Happy New Year and everything else that goes with all of that. Pleased to be with you today. I'm pleased that the snow stopped so we could meet together. We live in Grand Rapids, and we came over last night to stay with my mother-in-law, and leaving Grand Rapids, it was just horrible, going about 35 miles an hour down the interstate and couldn't see anything. And we thought, wouldn't that be terrible if we go all this way and then fifth cancels? But I'm glad that we're here, that we can worship our Lord and be with each other. Our scripture this morning comes to us from the Gospel of Mark, the 10th chapter. This is Epiphany, the time when we think of the 12 days of Christmas, as Darren mentioned. But I preached on the Magi New Year's Day last week. So we're not going to repeat that. I hope those of you who are here remember that story, and those of you who weren't here probably know the story anyway. But we're not going to look at that, but we're going to look at another passage, Mark 10, verses 17 through 22. And it says, as Jesus started on his way, a man ran up to him and fell on his knees before him. Good teacher, he asked, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Why do you call me good? Jesus answered. No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments. Do not murder, do not commit adultery, do not steal, do not give false testimony, do not defraud, honor your father and mother. Teacher, he declared, all these I've kept since I was a boy. Jesus looked at him and loved him. One thing you lack, he said, go sell everything you have and give it to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me. At this, the man's face fell. He went away sad because he had great wealth. This past Friday was Epiphany within the church, and I assume that you sent out your Epiphany cards, and I would imagine that under your Epiphany trees you have partridges in a pear tree and French hens floating around and maids milking and whatever that 12th one is. You know, we've mentioned the other ones all the times, but you get to the 12th one. What is the 12th one? I don't know. But anyway, Epiphany. Epiphany was an important time in the church years ago. It was a time to celebrate when Jesus began revealing himself to other people. And that is why the story of the Magi is an important story during this time. Jesus revealed himself to the Magi through the star, and the Magi came. Gentiles came to see Jesus. The Jews, other than the shepherds, didn't know he'd been born yet. But the Gentiles were shown the star and came to worship him. They came from what we know as Iran. And they came to praise God. That's good news for us Gentiles, unless we got some Jewish history in us. We were outside. But Epiphany is a day that we remember our ancestors, and we ourselves are brought into the family of God. Having said that, we're not here today to discuss Epiphany. The concept's very important, but we're not here to discuss it. We could come here this morning and consider the difference between the coming of the Magi and this man that we read about. The Magi, Gentiles, came a long way. They were gone for a long time. They brought gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh, to give to this newborn king. And they came to worship him. What did this Jewish man do? He came to Jesus. He didn't bring a gift. He didn't come to worship him. He came to see basically what he could get out of him. He had a question. He wanted to know the answer for his own sake. So there's a difference there. But we're not going to discuss that either. They're good things to think about, but we're not going to discuss them. So I want you to think about it later on. Today we're going to look at how Jesus handled a situation that is very common today, a situation that we see constantly within the church and constantly within the lives of Christians. It's a situation that places a lot of pressure upon the church and a lot of pressure on individual Christians. It's a situation that makes Christians and the Christian church quite unpopular today. We just finished celebrating the birth of Jesus, and we know that Jesus was human and Jesus is God. Jesus had given his law. Jesus had given his word. It had been in the Jewish society for 1,500 years. The words of Jesus, the words of God. Now he came to earth. But he didn't come to earth to conform his word to the people. He didn't come to conform his word to the society. He came to conform people to his word. He came to conform society to his word. That's a huge difference. He would not compromise his word. He would not compromise his law. He would not compromise it to the likes and dislikes of people. He came to conform his law and his word to make the people conform to them so they would follow it. You know, when most people think of Jesus, their relationship with him, whatever that relationship may be, they normally think, hey, I'm doing pretty good. I'm a good person, I got things under control, and I sure am a lot better than my neighbor, and I sure am a lot better than the person I work with. I'm a lot better than a lot of people I know. I'm good. I'm better. And that's kind of the way this man felt. He came to Jesus. Jesus was walking down the road, and this man came up to Jesus and asked him a very basic and a very complicated question. He says, good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Now, we're not really told if this man felt he was missing something. You know, he considered himself a good man. Was he missing something? Was he sincerely asking, what must I do? What am I missing in my life to inherit eternal life? Or maybe he thought, I'm pretty good. I'm not missing anything. But I want Jesus to confirm that. What must I do? And if Jesus says, oh, nothing, you're in, then he's in good shape. Now, as usual, if you read the Bible for any amount of time and you're looking at Jesus answering people's questions, he never answers them directly. Many times you look at his answers and you say, what? What is he trying to get to? So this man comes and he says, good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And what's the first thing that Jesus says? Why do you call me good? That's not the question. But that's what Jesus wanted to pursue. Why do you call me good? No one is good. No one is perfect except God alone. So the first thing Jesus wanted to do is straighten out this man's theology. Who is good? God. And Darren mentioned that earlier, and you said it too. God is good. And all the time? So who's good? God. Pretty basic. That's theology 101. God is good. So God, not man, is the measuring stick to determine what's good. God determines who is good, and only he is good. Then Jesus gets to answering the man's questions. What must I do to inherit eternal life? Well, Jesus says, well, you know the commandments. Don't murder, don't commit adultery, don't steal, don't give false testimony, don't defraud, honor your father and your mother. And the man says, well, teacher, notice he dropped the good part. He didn't want to go back into that discussion again. When he drops the good part, he says, teacher, I've done all that since I was a little kid. I'm in good shape. He may have thought he never broke the letter of the law. The Pharisees thought they never broke the letter of the law. I'm a good man. Let me get to the next verse. And Jesus looked at him and loved him. He was trying. He was trying so hard. He was following the religious teachings. He was trying to follow the law. He wasn't exactly there, but he was trying. And he was a good man. He did his very best. He wanted to inherit eternal life. Jesus loved him. That's quite a statement to make. Jesus loved him. You know, there are many people today like that young man. Maybe a person's been a lifelong member of the church. They always go to church. Whenever the church is open, they're there. They know the Ten Commandments. They can recite the Ten Commandments. They try to follow the Ten Commandments. They've read the scriptures. They can quote the scriptures. They can quote theology. But quite often in every person's life, there comes the question, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Have I made it or not? I've done all that the church has required of me. What more do I need? What more can I do? And there are other people who've never gone to church. Maybe they can quote one or two commandments. Never read the Bible, they can quote a few verses they've heard around. Haven't led a perfect life, maybe they haven't even led a good life. They're pretty sure they're better than their neighbor. They're pretty sure they're better than their coworker. But they ask the question, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Or is this all there is? Well, we go back to what Jesus said. Well, no one is good except God alone. You want to be good enough for eternal life? You have to be God. That means we got a problem, because we're not God. We're not God. Some people try to be God, but there's only one God, and only he is good. So what do we do if we're not God? We listen to God, and he'll tell us. Jesus looked at the man, he says, One thing you lack. Ooh, one thing. That's pretty close. So close. I got it. Just one thing I'm missing. Go sell everything you have and give it to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then you can come and follow me. Was Jesus saying this man had to be poor to inherit eternal life? No. Wasn't saying that at all. He pointed out that, sir, you're not perfect. You're not good. You have a problem. You have a serious problem. You claim to follow the God of the Jewish scriptures. You claim to follow his law. But your God is really your wealth. And that God is different for every person. But for this man, it was his wealth. What's the summary of the law? How do you condense the Ten Commandments? You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself. Whoops, he missed that one. He was in trouble. He was in trouble. The man loved his wealth. He loved his possessions. His wealth was his God. Not the God of the Jewish scriptures, not Jesus. His wealth. Now we could spend a lot of time talking about that, but we're not going to. We're going to go in another direction now. I should have given you all road maps so you could figure out where we're going. But that's an important thing to remember as well. What did the man do? He turned and walked away. Said his face fell. Can you kind of picture his jaw dropping? No, this is too much. This is too much. And he turned around and walked away. The passage said Jesus loved him. And then the passage tells us that Jesus turned and ran after the man. And he got to the man and he said, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to offend you. Let's sit down and discuss this. Maybe we can work out a compromise. I didn't really mean what I said. You know, it doesn't matter what you believe as long as you believe something. You tried. That's good enough. You're a good man. Is that what Jesus said? No. He let the man leave. Jesus would not change his word. Jesus would not change what he said. Jesus would not change his law. That was up to the man. His words were not up for discussion. His words were not up for revision. The man made his choice. It'd be wealth over God. Jesus loved the man. But he let him stick to that decision. The man walked away without what he needed for eternal life. You know, the pressure is on today to compromise the word of God if someone is offended. There was a thing in the news not too long ago where there was a public Christmas tree. It was on public land. They didn't say who put it up. But at the top was a cross. and a man sued because the sign of the cross on the Christmas tree brought him irreparable damage. If he wants irreparable damage, wait until he dies without the cross. People are offended. I don't want to see that. I don't want to look at that. I don't want to be told that. I don't want to be reminded of that. If it goes against people's beliefs, no, we don't want any part of it. Pressure to get the Bible, get rid of it, change it. If it goes against the beliefs of society, the ideas of society, personal beliefs, attitudes, actions, get rid of it, change it, compromise it, talk about it. Christians are called to apologize for the Bible, for what it says. How can we do that? We didn't write it. We don't have the authority to do that. If you want to talk to somebody and get an apology for somebody for what the Bible says, talk to God. You'll see him on Judgment Day. Talk to him then. When the man was offended by what Jesus said, Jesus did not apologize. He did not change what he said. It was up to the man to change. And he either could not or would not do it. So then it became his problem. It's not up to us to apologize or to change God's word or to compromise God's word. We can't make people believe in God. We can't make people accept Jesus Christ as their Savior. We can't make the Holy Spirit change a person's life. That's beyond our abilities. What we do is proclaim the truth of God's word, and we let the truth speak for itself. We let the truth impact people's lives without compromise, without revision. Without saying, well, you know, well, whatever you want to believe. No. Jesus never accepted that. Jesus was the most politically incorrect person who ever lived on the face of this earth. And we don't have to apologize for him. You know, we're told repeatedly, we have to be politically correct. No. You can't offend somebody. Jesus offended everybody. We are to keep the Christian faith to ourselves. We are to apologize when people tell us to apologize. Jesus never did. He never did. And if we follow him, if we believe in him, we don't apologize for his word either. When the man asked Jesus what he needed to do to inherit eternal life, Jesus pointed out what the man was missing. Total and complete love for God. The man said, no. Nope. Not going to do it. I'm going to keep my possessions. He would trust in what he believed in. He would trust in what he wanted to trust in. And that's where God's word offends people. They say, I want to trust this. God says, no, you trust me. I will trust it myself. No, you trust me. And people become offended. When it comes to God's word, we only have to do one thing. We have to do what Jesus did. Speak the truth from Scripture, and then let the truth speak for itself. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we come before you. We thank you for your word that you've given to us. We thank you for your law that you've given to us, that we may live longer lives and more fruitful lives. We thank you, Lord, for the many blessings you bestowed upon us. So, Lord, we just come before you and we pray that you would help us to proclaim your word through the things we say and through the things we do. May we give you honor and glory, and may we bring your truth into a world that needs to hear it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.